Ciao.
I knew that it had been a long time since my last album. Music changes so fast, and tastes and new genres and, you know, new producers, new styles come along. So I thought if anybody was going to care about a Mark Ronson album in 2015, it had to be, you know, the best thing I'd done. This is that ice cold Michelle
fight for that white gold. This one for them hood girls. When I first asked Michael if he would write the lyrics to the album, there was definitely a strong temptation in the beginning to make a story through the whole album. And then we wrote Uptown Funk and we were like, fuck, well, what are we gonna do? We're just gonna try and make this one story where they just go to a nightclub or something. So we realized that the songs were more interesting if they stood on their own. That way the listener and the audience can enjoy each thing. Like when I listen to some of my favorite albums, I like that and I get lost in the lyrics. Things like maybe Steely Dan or things that are very narrative, I get to decide the story for myself, not be told, hey, this is the story, this is what's happening, you know. You get to paint your own picture, which I like, so that's what we tried to do. Don't believe me, just watch. The 90s, when I started DJing in clubs in New York, I guess New York hip-hop, as far as Puffy, you know, Puff Daddy, Biggie, Jay-Z, was starting to become this scene, and it was in downtown New York where I was DJing, it was a mix of rappers, you know, athletes, sports stars, drug dealers, skateboarders, models. It was a mix of kind of every kind of, you know, culture, race, background. And people came for the music as well, you know, before you had VIP and bottle service and, you know, camera phones and people could still smoke in the club. It was a little bit more, the energy and the dancing thing was pretty amazing. So I feel lucky to have got to see some of that era. I mean, now there's still some good clubs and things like that. There's interesting scenes, but for the most part, I don't think it's quite as much about the music as maybe it used to be. Don't believe me, just watch. When I look back on the music that I like as a child, you know, as you're like, okay, well, why do I like this Duran Duran song, this David Bowie song, this In Excess song, this Madonna song? And then you get older and you realize because they were all produced by Nile Rodgers. As a DJ, in playing in black music clubs in New York, I've probably been playing Nile Rodgers music for 20 years of my life. So there's no way that I wouldn't be influenced by him. You know, in some way, he's one of the greatest producers, guitar players, I think, to ever be around. I think that it's never like a conscious thing when I'm making music, like, oh, let's make a record like this person or this person. It's just like, you know, we play the music that we love and try to make something new at the same time. So Nile is a big hero of mine. I have one guitar player who's my favorite guitar player, who played on Amy Winehouse Back to Black on my albums. And I played him Uptown Funk the first time, and he thought the guitar was Nile Rodgers, and it was me. So that was the best compliment I think anybody's ever played me. Don't believe me, just watch. Hey, hey.